I'm rolling.
You're rolling, bro.
All right. Thanks, bro. Can you close both those doors? All right, guys. What's up? Welcome back. I can't believe it. I'm making another YouTube video right now. The last two that I made went pretty freaking good, and I had fun doing them, and it looked like you guys enjoyed them, so I'm making another one. This time I wanted to talk about Impulsive a little bit. We're almost 90 episodes in. We're on our way to 100.
Alyssa Violet or your ex-girlfriend, Erica?
Holy shit! We've spent so much time together. We've laughed together a lot. We've cried together. Like, so much shit has gone down on the show. So I want to give you guys a little bit of a behind the scenes look, talk to you about each episode and some of the craziest moments that have happened since we started the world's number one podcast. So coming in at number 10, Charlie Rocket. This episode was crazy. I did not know what to expect. We knew Charlie was like a Grammy Award winning manager for 2 Chainz. He had lost a ton of weight. He was a Nike sponsored athlete. He had been through a brain tumor, all of this crazy shit. And he came on the show and he literally just took over. He was so positive, so inspirational. I remember during the podcast, I was just locked in on him. Me and Logan were both locked in on him completely. And he was talking about how he looks at every day as a winning streak.
I had to train myself, and I do this thing called I'm on a winning streak. It's a momentum. Literally the gym for momentum.
I actually went up after the show, printed out letters for winning streak and put them on my wall. And every day when I wake up in the morning now, I write something I'm thankful for on that winning streak that I've printed out and put on the wall. That episode was crazy. We got so much feedback from you guys on how inspirational he was. He taught us on the show to kind of just keep fighting through whatever adversity we face.
You're literally looking for the negatives, but what we have in our brains is this thing called the reticular activating system. And it's the part of our brain that filters. Like right now, your eyes are technically looking at like 10 million data points.
Yeah.
But it's only telling you a couple.
Charlie taught us so much about, you know, being yourself, loving yourself, and most importantly, manifesting your own destiny, knowing what you want, writing it down, and going after it every single day. And after that, we noticed that so many of our guests were using that same kind of quantum mentality. The more that they talked about shit, the more the chance that that shit would happen after they did it. If you haven't seen that episode, I would definitely go watch that. People love that episode. Coming in at number 9, our conversation with Gun Girl Caitlin Bennett. We knew we wanted to do this episode since the beginning of the show. Logan was always completely infatuated with this girl, Caitlin Bennett, who brought her AR-10 to campus with her for her graduation photos. The topic of gun control and Second Amendment rights is always on the top of all Americans' minds and a lot of people across the globe. And so we knew we wanted to touch on it, but we were a little bit nervous and a little bit worried if we were even going to be able to pull together enough knowledge on such an important and impactful topic to go up against one of the most active kind of proponents for gun rights in the country.
You have some very strong points, and I hate that you're gonna get lumped into the category of people that are clinically fucking insane. Okay,
like I don't agree with that.
That's fine. You don't have to, but understand that that's what 99.99% of this country thinks,
and that's fine.
And so, do you want to be the 0.001% of we're right, and every single other person is wrong? Like we talk about data. Maybe there are some times you should listen to it.
We studied for like 2 days before this podcast. I put everything I had into studying the different ins and outs of how people can get guns, mental health checks, background checks, the reasons why people wanted to own rifles with high capacity magazines, the laws on bump stocks, all those kind of things so that we could have this really, really good conversation. And make no mistake, Caitlin brought the pain. Like she literally came as studied and as knowledgeable as I knew she was going to. But this was the first episode where I found out that we were going to be versatile enough to hang with people that have supreme knowledge on a topic.
Alex Jones has been smeared by the media so many times.
He doesn't need a smear. I just watch him and watch the things he says, and it's pretty fucking evident the dude's got a problem.
It's not just you.
I gained a lot of respect for Spencer, and I gained a lot of confidence in myself on this episode to be able to have a conversation with one of the biggest names in an industry or in a movement and really hang in there. So that was another really powerful episode in our eyes, and definitely one of the more impactful ones that we've done so far. Number 8, one of your favorite podcasts. We've gotten so much feedback on this episode. The Wolf of Wall Street versus Spencer. So in the beginning of the show, I heard Jordan mention AOC, of course, the representative from New York that's always talking about climate change and the Green New Deal. We kind of switched topics, but I heard him say it just barely. And so later on in the show, I brought up AOC again and I brought up the Green New Deal. I knew it was going to spark this huge like reaction from him.
You know, the fucking volcano erupts. Just, dude, the fucking, the only thing true about climate change is it's always changing.
Always, for the last, you know, how many millennia, right?
It was incredibly apparent that him and Spencer had completely different viewpoints.
Okay? I don't know
about
that.
No, it's just
that.
Not true, okay? So it's
there's,
just not
there's
true.
A majority of no. scientists that have
not true.
Evidence that humans
no, it's not true.
Are amplifying
not true.
Climate change.
It's not true.
Yeah, that, where no, are you getting that from?
Go dig into the facts. That 95% is a select yeah. group of people that all agree in climate change. That's who they poll.
And they got into this super heated argument right away. Spencer was talking about the proof that scientists have that climate change is real. Jordan Belfort kept saying it's not true, it's not true. It moved on to Jordan calling him buddy and kid and all of these different like demeaning words.
Let me interject.
It's just not true.
You have to step back.
I have
back.
Friends down
it's
in
not
the
true. Go Google it.
That are NASA showing images
everybody
of
everybody needs to
yeah in one spot
they're there.
It's increasing and it's twice as much as increasing.
But
else.
That's because of
mass
of,
gains
mass
of,
gains of yeah. I don't think I should grade the losses. Thank you very much. Don't fucking tell me, pal, okay?
Me and Logan actually argued about this a little bit. What else is new afterwards? Because I kept trying to butt in. I thought they were literally going to like fight like bad. And I also wanted to like steer it back towards a conversation that actually had some merit to it. Because at this point, they were just completely talking over each other. No one was getting anything done.
Let's all step back for a sec. I want to say something.
Dude, you can't.
There are equal sources on both sides of the spectrum. I'm not saying
you're
things.
Wrong. I can't say you're wrong, but I'm not saying you're definitely. How could you be so certain? Who fucking knows what's going on?
I think
on?
You're assuming.
You want to protect the planet because we live
of
here,
course.
Right? But the fucking climate is a joke. It's a fucking
who do you
nonsense.
Think? Who do you
well,
think
I,
is
like,
the
okay,
right?
Wait.
I also wanted to jump in to defend Spencer a little bit. A lot of the points he was making were pretty obvious. I'd never thought that I would be on a show with The Wolf of Wall Street, and I don't think Spencer had ever anticipated that he would have gotten into a full-blown argument with him. So I was sitting there just thinking about how I could like break them up, and Logan was just having so much fun watching them go back and forth. On it, and that was definitely another one of the funnest moments that we've had on the show so far. Coming in at number 7, the Rocka Rocka twins. We spent so much time with the Rocka twins, mostly Danny in the time leading up to the KSI fight, but Mike as well. And these guys are absolutely nuts. Everybody knows that. Leading into that episode was a lot of the controversy about them being demonetized on YouTube and not being able to make money. And so we didn't know what to expect from them. They're always completely crazy and over the top. But we did talk to them beforehand about getting these fake bottles that we could smash over each other's head in the middle of the episode. And I didn't know when it was gonna happen, and then Mike started like chirping at Danny, and I knew it was like building up to, and then out of nowhere Danny smashes the bottle on Mike's head, Logan smashes the bottle on my head, I smash the bottle on Logan's head. It was complete pandemonium, and I didn't know what to expect getting hit with one of those things. Kind of hurts, not gonna lie. It kind of feels like a really light actual bottle.
You keep talking curse. I smash this bottle on you. Oh, shit.
Shut up.
I'll tell you to.
You shut the fuck
Yo,
up Mike.
All right, right
you're
now?
An idiot Mike.
Oh.
That was one of the highest energy podcasts that we had so far, but it was also a really good conversation about YouTube and censorship and being demonetized.
Please don't demonetize this, YouTube.
They will.
You think so? You think that's going to cause an age gap?
That really was fake props, YouTube, yeah. Fake, you know, it was planned.
I was really close to jumping on the table and jumping on you, but I didn't want to break it.
None of that was easily recreatable by those watching the program, YouTube.
That was a stunt performed by professionals.
And so that was another one of the podcasts that we had a ton of fun on. Coming in at number 6, the Call Her Daddy girls. This episode was absolutely bonkers, start to finish. We didn't know what we were gonna get into. We didn't know what topics this was gonna go towards, where these girls were gonna take us, where we were gonna take them. We started the episode off with shots of vodka, and it continued to just evolve or devolve into this 3-hour marathon of just some of the most like adult, gruesome, vicious sexual topics that we had ever discussed at this point.
This is the last one.
Wait,
we
can I have more water though?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we'll get it for
I'm
you.
A little parched up in this bit. Oh, thanks, Luke. Is this alcohol too?
You could see Spencer's face the entire time. He was completely uncomfortable with that episode, and rightfully so. He's got a completely different vibe than me and Logan. He works on a lot of stuff having to do with education and children, and so he was really out of his element, and we were all super happy that he hung in there.
It's like a sixth sense, intuition.
ESPN.
I can look at you guys and I know.
I'm not gonna take out my
flash window, it under the table. Just
fucked
like
up part is I will.
That episode really continued to show us how far we could push the envelope with this show. Alexandra and Sophia Media are absolutely amazing. What they're doing with Call Her Daddy is just incredible to watch. They have one of the most watched shows in the country, and we love talking to them. We love working with them. I want nothing more than to collab with them again. Hopefully we'll have them back on the show again soon, or we'll go on their show. We were super happy with how that episode turned out, and I think everybody in the audience was super happy about it too. Coming in at number 5, me and Logan fighting on the Dwarf Mamba episode. This is a recent one, just aired if you're seeing this. Probably one of the deepest episodes that we have ever done. Tears were shed, feelings were hurt. It was just a wild episode from start to finish. Logan had talked a lot about it in the episodes leading up to it, but when he spars before the podcast, he gets really hot, really aggressive. I had probably interrupted him. And I want to touch on the interrupting really quick too. It's something we all continue to work on. You'll notice Logan also interrupts me a lot. I interrupt Spencer. It is really, really hard for 4 people, 3 co-hosts and a guest to have a collaborative conversation. There is toe stepping. There is people jumping in when maybe they should have waited another second. I think we've gotten much better at not interrupting. I've gotten much better at not interrupting, but we do continue to step on toes here and there. It's just the way things will always be when you have 3, 4, 5 people talking at the same time, all with huge personalities, big energies, and great stories to tell. So that episode started off, we were talking about Black Mirror, and I just have not been a fan of the season. I've been really vocal about that on Twitter, on YouTube, and Logan asked me how I felt about the episode. I was trying to compare it to other seasons, and I think I'd cut him off again.
Wow, literally, fuck.
We just wasted another 10 seconds.
Bro, Logan, eat the fattest cock in the history of the world, you moron. You fucking moron.
I'm not gonna do it.
Shut the fuck up.
Because the episode where it was just us, dude, I saw so many comments that were like, yo, Mike, please just
You know how many comments I see that are like, I never fucked with Logan Paul or his stupid vlogs till you came on and brought the adult range in? I see just as many comments. Okay, I'll show them to you. People are like, I don't care about Logan's 12-year-old vlogs.
And he said something to me and I completely flipped out, and it just turned into this really, really crazy interaction, altercation between me and Logan. You guys have seen it by now, but that was definitely one of the hottest, most heated moments that me and Logan have ever had in the history of our relationship. Completely wild. I didn't know if we were going to get in a fist fight. I didn't know what was going to happen.
I'm like, you have 9,000 followers on Twitter. I can assure you, no one gives a fuck, bro. And he was freaking out from such a micro influencer.
What I'm saying
is
this.
You act like you're so macro.
All I'm saying is, tread lightly, man. Don't piss off the sponsors. Tread lightly, man, okay?
We don't have sponsors.
I know, because you fucked us.
That was just the beginning of a crazy episode that continued to just get crazier after that. Number 4, continuing on with the same episode, Dwarf Mamba, the powerhouse episode. Logan calling out David Dobrik for being on the podcast set. We had made decisions not to mention it, just because we've been really trying to play it cool, focus on ourselves, focus on the content that we're making. Views have been going so well and everything's been going so great that we made the decision not to really talk about this. As you know, if you've seen the episode, during Logan's luau, David and Jeff and Corinna came back to the podcast without us knowing about it, filmed some content on it. I don't think we really would have had a problem with that, but supposedly, I've not seen the footage, but some jokes were made that Logan caught on his Nest cameras about Japan and the Suicide Forest that were kind of tasteless.
I have security cameras everywhere in my house.
Yeah.
So I went on and I looked at the time when David, Corinna, and Jeff were on the studio.
And you could hear what they were saying.
I could hear what they were saying. Okay. They made a Suicide Forest joke. One of them, Jeff was actually, it was caught on camera. Someone like Instagrammed him and he was like making fun of me and my mistakes and my controversy. Jeff, what's fucking good, bro? Then you text me the next day and you say you want to go running at Runyon Canyon or you want to box sometime? Like, please, please come over and we can handle this like fucking men.
And I think after the fight between me and Logan, he was just so angry and so pissed off and in his own head that he just decided he was just going to break the thing wide open. Spencer got on Logan's side and I tried to play devil's advocate as much as possible, calling it a joke. Now that I've had time to think about it, I think it actually was more fucked up than I originally thought, especially now that David and Logan aren't great friends anymore. And Corinna and Logan obviously aren't talking or dating anymore. That they would have a conversation about something that really hurts Logan so badly.
Why are people coming into your house disrespecting your set and what you've done? I get it. A lot of it is for the content and that's part of their life. That's part of what they do. But when it comes down to like, you're pulling up the same thing. Not only were they doing that to you too, what I actually thought was really fucked up was they talked to Hayden. Like they pulled Hayden aside and the only thing they said to him was, Yeah, I'll let you say it. I don't fully remember.
David goes, oh, you edited the Suicide Forest video. Like, David, shut the fuck up, dude. For real. Like, time to move on. We get it. You're hot shit now. I think I can speak for everyone who knows you. If you keep this attitude up, your time is coming. I was there, dude. I was fucking there. So ease up, Tiger.
And so I'm filming this right now. The Dwarf Mamba episode hasn't even come out yet. And so I don't know how the world is going to react to this. I don't know if Keemstar is going to pick it up. I don't know what people are going to say about them making jokes about something that impacted Logan's life in such a big way. But all I can say is, I guess once the smoke settles, hopefully Jeff, Corinna, David, maybe one of you guys be willing to come on the show to talk about what happened, how it went down, and kind of clear the air about that so we could all be friends. Number three, Alex Jones. This episode was probably the wildest episode that we had in the history of the show. So much went into this episode. So much conversations with PR teams, managers, agents, YouTube. The consequences of having this completely infamous activist on the show after he's been shut off of so many channels, including YouTube, including Twitter, including Facebook, including every other social channel. He had just been on Joe Rogan. The episode went crazy. They had a great conversation. And we wanted so badly to get Alex on the show to dig into his brain and more so to kind of put some fire on his ass for some of the shit that he had said about Sandy Hook, about some of the other things he had talked about. When he came on the show, I completely did not expect this from him, but he wanted to start drinking. He started drinking completely aggressively, downing cup after cup of vodka. I was just completely in shock of the whole situation. And earlier that morning, I had spoke to a friend of mine back in Connecticut because I'm from not far from Sandy Hook. And he had told me that he had talked to a friend of his that said that he was willing to pay $100,000 if I punched Alex Jones in the face on our show. I don't think I ever really thought about doing it. Even though it was $100,000, I wasn't gonna do that to one of our guests. It's illegal. I was gonna get arrested. And plus, I just don't believe in that kind of shit. As mad as I was at Alex Jones, as pissed off as I was about the stupid shit that he had said so ignorantly about Sandy Hook, I just didn't think I was gonna be able to do it or I would even think about doing it. And when I told him that, he stood up and came over to me and I was like, yo, I feel like this dude's about to fight me. Like, I might have to punch him in the face right now. He was, of course, joking. He started punching himself in the face, smashing his head on the table. That entire episode was just completely bonkers, completely nuts.
One reached out to me today and offered me six figures to punch you in the face on the fucking show. I'm not kidding about this.
And by the way, he's going to do it.
No, I'm not.
No, he is.
Was that Posner?
No, I'm not.
Was that Posner?
No, I'm not going to say who it was.
I'm going to let you do it.
No, I refuse. And by the way, by the way, listen to me. I won't do it.
I'll do it.
We'll split them. No, Alex,
that's
stop.
Like five punches.
Alex, stop.
He was such an incredible manipulator and marketer. By 3/4 of the way through the episode, he got me to start kind of buying into some of the shit he was saying. Not really believing it, but just being more like friendly with him than I should have been. Logan and Spencer really put up no fight. They were completely open to like any of the stuff he was saying, which is fine. They were being more interviewers, but I wanted to take more of a hard stance, and I still kind of feel a little bit of regret for not taking as hard of a stance as I should against him for a lot of the ignorant shit that he said.
And that's my problem. At a certain point, the fourth time, we're gonna get you. I walk out there, F you, eat shit.
Saw that.
We're gonna get you. But they all edit it where headlines, The Daily Beast, Washington Post, Jones comes up to an innocent table of
Hey, listen, liberals. You're right. I saw that. I saw that video. And by the way, I heard the things that people were saying to you. And so my thought on it is I try to stay center of the road on shit. I try to.
It's good.
People were saying shit to you. That was disgusting. Like, I heard it, and it was a form of bullying.
And I was that you only yeah, saw
but,
the
yeah,
end of it.
Yeah, yeah, but do you think he's sort of...
Oh, you were asking
brought that
act.
Upon yes. himself?
That was a question. Maybe,
but at what point...
Like, you
point,
can't tell me no.
No, I'm also. not saying he hasn't. But like, I prefaced
You early, sleep in the bed you make.
I prefaced earlier with Sandy Hook. I know some of the parents. They fucking hate you.
And we did get a lot of blowback from some of the higher-ups at YouTube because of that video. It almost turned into another major scandal with us. And so that was just a really wild episode and just a really wild guess. But I don't regret having him on. It was just so eye-opening. And I think the biggest takeaway for people who watch that episode is that maybe you don't have to pay as much of a mind to what he says as you originally thought. I don't think he's all there. Like, I think he's been through so much trauma and just has put himself in through such a crazy like chain of thinking that he's not really all there. And so he's not thinking through what he says. He's not completely sane. You've heard about what he said about himself on Joe Rogan. I'm not gonna repeat it. That was just a wild episode. We were all just kind of hanging on to the bull while it was bucking and just holding on for our dear lives. So yeah, that was nuts. Coming in at number two, I'm sure you guys expected this to be on there, me versus Hi, My Name Is T. I talked about this in the first video I made last week with questions from fans. I'm spotting a trend here. Another episode where we started drinking. T came over. She wanted to drink Hennessy. We drank Hennessy. I talked about wearing the trippy red shirt by accident. There was another part of this that we haven't really talked about. This is a little bit of tea that I'm going
to
spill.
They just wanted to talk to me to see if I was naturally funny, I think. And, you know.
Did you freestyle?
Yeah, no, I didn't freestyle. I had a rap prepared.
Can you do a roast of Mike right now? I'll give you like 10 seconds. Thing, but like,
I'm sure you got
something prepared.
I mean, like,
It'd be cool if you rapped it.
There was a lot of sexual energy between Logan and T during the episode. Some people who watched the episode thought there was more sexual tension between me and T. That really wasn't the case. T and Logan were really going back and forth, and you could really see it in the way that Logan was approaching her. He was just really bigging her up, and he just kept like complimenting her on everything, even though like he really didn't know anything about her until that day. And so,
hey, you reserved it like that?
I mean, yeah.
I'm always so intrigued. And by the way, you could sit down whenever you want.
Well, I don't know if I can.
That episode, really, the tension just continued to build and build and build and build until we all know what happened. It turned into this massive thing. I saw her pick up the glass. I knew she was about to throw it on me. And so I kind of ran out of the way, ran out of there. I did not really know if I should come back to that episode. I kind of wanted to just sit it out for a little while and see what I should do. I came back and tempers kind of continued to flare. I did my best to apologize to her. She obviously wasn't having it.
Living in the hood, if you pour that drink on me, I'm gonna kick your ass. Fuck.
Oh, shit.
The feedback I got from the fans on that episode was so wild. Like, I think that episode was really one of the biggest, like, respect builders that I got from you guys. Just because people saw that I was never going to back down. I will never back down to anyone. I'll take anything that comes head on. Even when it comes to, like, freestyling against people who can freestyle, or in her case, can't freestyle. And so I got a ton of respect, a ton of great comments out of that. And it was just great viewing. It was just great broadcasting. We had a ton of fun. It was super hot, kind of aggressive, but it was just really fun to watch. And so I don't regret anything that happened on that episode. Me and T are friends now, and it was just super fun to watch. Coming in at number one, I'm sure you guys guessed this, our friend Riley Reed. This was our breakthrough episode of Impulsive. I think leading up to this episode, we still really didn't know what our tone was gonna be, what our voice was gonna be, what we were gonna talk about. So this was back in the beginning when I was still sitting on the other side of the guest. If you remember in the first episodes of Impulsive, I sat on the right side of the guest. I'll give you guys a little behind the scenes reason as to why we switch. As you guys know, I like to talk. I like to lock eyes with the guest. Spencer likes to really come in at more strategic times with more heartfelt and impactful questions. And we just noticed that the guest was having a hard time interacting with me and making eye contact with me when I was sitting on the opposite side of them. And so a few episodes after Riley, we made the decision to switch me to the other side of the table. It also allowed me and Logan to work together through body cues and verbal cues that you guys might not always see. So just some tactical behind the scenes stuff for you guys. But back to Riley Reed. So she comes on, she sits down, and it's just basically off to the races from the very start. There's a lot of it that I'm not gonna replay for this video. You guys have all seen it by now, assuming that you're 18 plus. But this episode really showed us just how far we could take this show.
Shooting the next scene, and she was like in makeup, and he liked her. So she did us the favor of standing in the corner of the room while he and I shot the scene.
Can I just,
and
he, can I just say fuck that guy?
And
I'm sorry, honestly, thank you so much to that girl
because that girl like saved the fucking day and got the scene done. So she was a fucking trooper. Yeah. So like badass.
And that we weren't going to be scared of talking about anything. We discussed some of the most sexual deviant topics of all time on this show. And we became such good friends with Riley after this episode. She is an absolute angel. We love her so much. We maintain contact with her. And this really became one of the staple episodes of Impulsive. We covered some just crazy topics, and it's actually, I think, the second or third most viewed video, with ASMR Girl being number one still. And so obviously this episode means a lot to me, as you guys know, being such a fan of Riley as I am. I got a chance to connect with her, and this kind of launched the relationship, friendship, whatever you want to call it, that me and her have today. And so we'd love to have Riley back on for round two. She'll probably bring a couple of her friends on this time. I don't want to talk about it too much, but definitely be looking for that in the future. And so that's it, guys. Top 10 craziest impulsive moments. This show has completely changed my life, has completely changed the vibe of the whole camp here at Maverick. Me, Logan, Spencer, the producer, Andre, the camera, like everyone involved, we love this show so much. We love the feedback we get from you guys. People stop me every single day. They message me, they come up to me in the streets. They just love the vibe of the show. We're not scared to talk about anything we'll have on any guest. We don't care if we have to demonetize it. We don't care if we have to deplatform it. We will continue bringing the pain, talking about the hard-hitting topics. I will continue asking the hard questions, and I will continue making these videos. I'm having fun talking to you guys in a more intimate setting, and as long as you guys fuck with me, I'll keep making the videos. So thanks for tuning in. Be sure to subscribe to my channel. Drop a comment below. Check me out on Instagram, Hey Big Mike. And most importantly, keep showing us all the love that you're showing us. We are so grateful for you guys on Impulsive. From all of us to you, thank you so much, and we'll see you guys again soon.